I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So happy Easter! It's still Easter. Come on, I'm like Rick, like 50 days, and I haven't been able to preach since Palm Sunday. So it's been like a month, and so you're just gonna have to bear with me because I got a lot to talk about, and I'm gonna get it all out today. And I have to make apologies to our Episcopal flock, but the Lutheran sheep have never heard this one, so I'm gonna go with it again. 7 young priests walk into a bar. The waitress leads them outside to one of those little patio beer garden things and pushes 2 tables together for them, hands them the beer list. All of the priests ordered their drinks and started gabbing about church politics, as they always do, and how the liturgy could have been better at the gathering they just attended. The priest's nerd chatter continued. The waitress bought them their drinks with a puzzled look on her face. The priest witnessed to the waitress that they began talking and preparing for Sunday's sermon. Everyone knew it was Good Shepherd Sunday, and one of the priests said they were looking for a good sermon illustration. Just when he said that, they all heard a guy scream and a bunch of commotion. They turned around and saw this guy jump over the fence, the beer fence, unsuccessfully trying to get onto the patio, in the process sending a palm tree and clay pot rolling and metal chairs tumbling. His friends were laughing uncontrollably at him. As soon as the luckily uninjured guy stood up, his friend walked 5 feet down the beer garden fence and said, "Dude, the gate's right here." It was funny 3 years ago. Every fourth Sunday of Easter, we preachers look for new images to bring this story to life. Every third year, we get this passage from Jesus, this year about Jesus as the gate. I was having lunch with my former rector of St. Margaret's in Annapolis last week. When we were working there, we had a big flock, over 400 on a Sunday morning, 100 kids in the day school, $4 million in an endowment. We had a lot of fun together. But finally, after 7 years ago, he decided it was too much for him. He loved the people, but the environment was his passion. And the job was too much. He left St. Margaret's and moved to Bentonville, Virginia, where he bought a farm and founded a smaller Sunday flock to pastor with maybe 30 on a Sunday. So several other clergy and I were at lunch with him last week, and we all said, "Okay, Mark, we need a sermon illustration, and you know, we hear you have these sheets, so you know, come on, give us something." There was a bloody story that follows that I will skip for your benefit. He hires someone now to do the shearing. The cover of your bulletin is actually of his barn and his flock. Mark said he was about to go buy some more sheep. "Those new sheep," he said, "won't know my voice yet. I'll have to teach them by feeding them. I'll teach them my voice by feeding them." Preach on that, he said. And we will. How do you know the voice of the Good Shepherd? You learn it by partaking the food he gives you, in the breaking of bread, in the fellowship, and in the prayers. We learn about the generous, abundant love of God by partaking in the bread and the wine, the sacrament of Christ's body and blood given for us on the cross for our forgiveness and eternal life. We learn that whenever we open our hands and say we are hungry, it will be provided. And then, as the gate, Jesus sends us out of here to bring others in. I hope the image of the Good Shepherd comforts you. Sunday school teachers around the country are now putting Elmer's glue and cotton balls and making little sheep, and it sticks in a really nasty way. Those of you from Holy Comforter still have that image of the Good Shepherd, the image of Jesus carved in wood over your altar with sheep at his feet. Perhaps that sheep over his shoulder is the blind man he had just healed on the Sabbath a few verses earlier. Perhaps that sheep is you, found not once and for all, but once again. As like me, you have erred and strayed in the valley of the shadow of death this week in one way or another. Jesus welcomes us back home to the feast, once again in green pastures, as we are comforted by his rod and his staff. Perhaps I should end there, but I have 3 weeks more of things I want to talk to you about. I just can't get one word out of my head after studying these readings this week. And that one word, the magic word for today and for the rest of your week, is generosity. Those who have been baptized devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone. Did y'all hear that? Awe, because many wonders and signs were being done. And everyone who believed, they were gathered together and they held things in common. And they would sell things to help one another. Day by day, as they spent more time together, they broke bread and ate together with glad and generous hearts. Praising God. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. After seeing the generosity of this first Christian flock, awe came upon everyone, and the Lord added. Now, it is no secret that I am passionate about growing the church. I was proud this week when at another event with a bunch of clergy and others, an old curmudgeon politely started giving me the old story about how the church is in decline and going downhill fast, and that he was a traditionalist and he was sinful, but that no one wanted to talk about sin anymore, and so the church was doomed. Thankfully, the Lord allowed me to swallow my drink instead of spit it in his face. Well, sir, I do hope you will get out and see some of the rest of the church, I said. I have a very different experience. I said, we aren't afraid to talk about our sin and brokenness in my community, and we are growing in faith and number. Well, are y'all still doing that jazz vespers thing? He said, I said, we are. He said, well, good luck with that. And I said, thank you. I am passionate about Jesus and his body, the church, and the way to invite others and teach them and lead them to the good shepherd of our souls is to feed them generously. That's the reason I'm still part of this wild and broken, beautiful, and sacred institution we call the church. And generously feeding others is the only way I can figure, either theologically or practically, to show them the abundant life and grace that awaits them. Another friend and Episcopal mentor of mine is Sam Candler. He's the dean of the Cathedral of St. Philip in Atlanta, which is like, I think, the second largest Episcopal church. So probably will see like 2,000 or 3,000 people this morning, and they have plenty of money because he's Candler of like the Coca-Cola Candler family, so they're fine. He wrote this week in his regular morning talk that he puts online that folks actually are accusing him when they ask him this question, why are fewer people at church on Sunday morning? As if spirituality is waning and as if that lack of Sunday attendance indicates that our church's influence is waning. His response is always this, he says, do you still watch the 6 p.m. news on your television every evening? A generation ago, much of culture gathered in a particular spot. I grew up that way. It was Walter Cronkite and then Dan Rather. At a particular time, and each day to receive and share the news, to watch it or listen to it. Today, he says, that common time no longer exists. It doesn't mean that the news is no longer important. It doesn't mean that the major networks are no longer effective. It simply means that times have changed. We are indeed a scattered flock in many different ways. Dean Candler suggests that we stop worrying, though,
about average Sunday attendance, as our church and bishops require us to record on these horrible little forms. He says we should work towards average weekly engagement. Not ASA, but AWE, awe. He's good. I love this. How do we increase our awe but continuing to show others? The abundant life is all about that. In all that we do and say, to share the abundant food of God's grace. You don't have to go invite all your friends to come to our church necessarily, but you can teach them about what you find here by showering upon them the food of God's generosity. It is a biblical early church model of evangelism, if you go back to the book of Acts. Awe comes upon them because what was being done there by the apostles, and day by day the Lord added. All right. Jesus is the good shepherd, welcoming us to the table, feeding us abundantly, then leading us out of this place. More importantly, evidently, that's translated as throwing them out, throwing us out, because Jesus didn't say, you have to go build a building and stay in it. He said, go. Go. So this week, in whatever and all that you do, be generous. What you're doing is making a difference in this place. Two more stories. I told you I had a lot to get out. It's working. Number one, there are more people in the pews, and so that's good, and God is adding. But number two, like, the word is getting out that, like, y'all are here and having fun and that you're a beautiful flock. Because this morning at the early service, which is 16 people every Sunday, always 16, maybe 20 on a good day, and so there are two newcomers in the front pew, and I thought, huh, who are they? And so I felt like maybe I didn't remember them, or I hadn't met them, and they were back from like a long time ago. And so I went and introduced myself at the piece, and they said, oh, we're from Florida. Our son told us to come here. And so afterwards I got the story, and I said, well, who's your son? And they said, well, actually his daughter goes to yoga in the church, and she's not all about church and stuff, but they told us this was the place to come if we wanted to. Ding. This week, someone else came to my office and said, I have a surprise for you. I want to have tea with you. And I said, okay, great. I love tea. And this person said, I have a surprise for you. I love what's going on here. And here's a $10,000 check for the endowment to keep it going. Okay? It's working. These are signs, friends, that what we are doing in this place, what God is doing through us, is making a difference. So thank you and keep it up. Be generous in all that you do. Remember that magic word this week. Be generous, if you can, with what you have. Be generous in forgiving. Be generous with food, with your laughter, with your joy, with your compassion, your hugs, and your humor. And they will come, because awe will be upon them by what they see through you. The light of Christ come for the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.